This week on Jerusalem Dateline, Hamas reaches a new height thanks to the United States, and police arrest a Muslim radical after three deaths at a Jewish museum in Brussels. Why European leaders fear there could be more like him. Plus, abused Christians in Egypt. Will political change mean a better life for the Coptic Christians? Hello, I'm Chris Mitchell. Welcome to this edition of Jerusalem Dateline, coming to you this week from our Jerusalem studio. The inclusion of Hamas into the new Palestinian Authority government is drawing criticism from Israel, but acceptance from a large number in the international community. But what's most troubling here in Israel is that now the Obama administration is recognizing the new government. Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas swore in his unity government on Monday and ended 7 years of division between Hamas and Fatah. Interim Palestinian Prime Minister Rami Hamdallah said the government is committed to international agreements signed by the PLO.
We call on the international community to immediately recognize the government and continue to support the Palestinian political leadership efforts to enable the government to face all political challenges, especially the Israeli policies.
Israel expressed its disappointment and threatened sanctions against the Palestinian Authority. Officials here in Jerusalem warned the world community there's a great deal at stake at this time. By recognizing this new government, they're also embracing a terrorist group.
Hamas is a ruthless terrorist organization responsible for the murder of countless innocent civilians, and an organization that says my country, Israel, should be destroyed.
But the State Department said it would judge the new government by its actions.
Based on what we know now, we intend to work with this government, but we'll be watching closely to ensure that it upholds the principles that President Abbas reiterated today.
Israeli government advisor Dori Gold says the move is a mistake.
The state of Israel is deeply disappointed in the statements made yesterday by the State Department spokesperson to not immediately reject Hamas, to not call on Mahmoud Abbas to break away from Hamas is a very big mistake.
It also puts the U.S. administration at odds with the U.S. Congress. Republican Senators Marco Rubio and Mark Kirk called on the U.S. to halt and review U.S. aid to the Palestinian Authority, saying U.S. law is clear. Unless Hamas publicly accepts Israel's right to exist and ceases its support for terrorism, U.S. aid should be suspended to any Palestinian government over which Hamas exercises influence. The administration's initial reaction to continue aid is outrageous and runs counter to existing law. We call on the Obama administration to enforce the law. U.S. credibility, as well as Israel's security, are at stake. Their call now draws the battle line between the U.S. Congress and the administration. As you can see from our story, we interviewed government advisor Dori Gold. Here's more of that interview with Gold, where he said Israel is considering its own actions, and he described the new Palestinian government as revolutionary. Ambassador Gold, how would you describe what's just happened with the Palestinian Authority and Hamas?
Well, in terms of international diplomacy, this is a tidal wave. This is a revolutionary change in which Mahmoud Abbas, who's been at the center of peacemaking for so many years, decides to ally himself with an international terrorist organization, not just defined by Israel, but by the United States, the European Union. You know what? The Egyptians see Hamas as collaborating with the jihadists who are attacking Egyptian sites in the heart of Cairo and all along the Nile Delta. So we have a serious problem with who Mahmoud Abbas is making friends with.
Now, the State Department says that it wants to see what this government will do. It will work with this government. Do you think that's... What's your reaction, first of all, to the U.S. State Department?
We are now facing a rising tide of jihadism across the Middle East, from Afghanistan, across North Africa, and, of course, in the heart of the Middle East, in Syria. And these organizations are now threatening the security of key American allies in Europe. We've had attacks against Jews in Belgium and France. And Hamas is part of that jihadist world. And to not reject the partnership between Mahmoud Abbas and Hamas is a terrible error. It's an error for international security, and it is a terrible error for peace.
Based on this reaction by the U.S. State Department and what the Palestinian Authority has done, how can Israel respond?
Well, Israel is weighing its options. It's having cabinet meetings. It's looking at how to effectively send a message to Mahmoud Abbas, but at the same time, not causing harm to the Palestinian population. We will look for ways to maneuver in that very difficult frame. We also have a problem for the international community. If the United States ultimately accepts the alliance between Abbas and Hamas, that will have a dramatic effect on many other American partners in Europe and elsewhere. It'll make our job much more difficult. But ultimately, the Prime Minister of Israel must defend the people of Israel. And he cannot allow an international terrorist organization to be legitimized.
Mahmoud Abbas, and it's been described, even the State Department said this is a technocratic government, and that they will accept those three conditions that the quartet has posed. How do you respond to that?
Well, you know, when we started the process called Oslo, the Oslo peace process in 1993, we demanded that the party, the PLO, change. It was the PLO that had to state that it recognizes Israel, that it renounces violence. We didn't allow for an arrangement by which the PLO could pick a number of suits to sit in the front of the store, and that would be sufficient. We demand that the party itself change. So what we're doing now, by allowing Hamas to basically get a pass and not having to state that it accepts what are called the quartet principles, recognizing Israel, accepting past agreements, renouncing violence above all, we're now lowering the bar. The bar for the Palestinians today is lower than it was in 1993 in the Clinton administration.
Do you see that Israel will take any unilateral steps?
Well, I think Israel will consider what it maybe should do. And it has to very carefully look at what unilateral options may be considered. This is now an issue largely discussed in sort of political chatter in Israel. You have to remember, when Israel captured the West Bank in a war of self-defense in 1967, that was a long time ago. And therefore, Israel was entitled to secure and recognized boundaries in the words of the UN Security Council. So if Israel cannot reach secure and recognized boundaries, defensible borders, by a compromise with the Palestinians, then it may have to find other ways of doing so.
Does this action legitimize Hamas?
Which action?
The action, the unity government.
Well, the unity government raises a dilemma for the international community. Should Hamas be supported or should Hamas be rejected? There's an enormous opportunity for leading members of the international community to say to Mahmoud Abbas, get rid of Hamas and we can move forward. But instead, what we're seeing is a readiness to consider working with the Abbas-Hamas axis. And that's very dangerous, because that could lead to a legitimization of the Hamas movement, not only by the Muslim Brotherhood, but by the West as well.
Coming up, how the Syrian civil war is raising concerns about radical Islam in Europe. That story and more in our weekly news wrap-up.
Pat Boone here with a word about bank safety. Do you think your money is safe in the bank? Don't bank on it. A generation ago, bank accounts felt secure and they paid interest. This encouraged the virtue of thrift and saving. But today, bank accounts pay virtually nothing, and they've shifted from low risk to high risk. For example, did you know your money deposited in most U.S. banks could be subject to limited withdrawal and even confiscation? Oh, yes. And that's just the first of 19 risks explained in a new white paper entitled, Don't Bank on It. You still think your bank deposits are safe? You better get this vital new Don't Bank on It white paper now. Call the number on the screen or visit SwissAmerica.com, the gold standard. Learn how simple it is to become your own banker today.
Millions of Americans with an ostomy live their lives to the fullest every day. And over the last 10 years, thousands have chosen Liberator Medical as their caring and reliable resource for ostomy supplies. Liberator Medical is a nationally accredited Medicare, Medicaid, and insurance provider, so we can handle all your Medicare, Medicaid, and insurance paperwork and billing. And Liberator Medical has been chosen as a preferred supplier by all the leading ostomy manufacturers, including Coloplast, Hollister, ConvaTec, and Generics. We supply all these leading ostomy brands so you can always get the ostomy supplies and accessories you want and trust. And all of our ostomy care specialists are product certified by the manufacturers. Shipping is free and discreetly delivered right to your door. Unhappy with your present ostomy supplier? Call Liberator Medical and ask about our free ostomy sampling program. We also offer catheters and urological supplies. Call 1-800-513-3076. That's 1-800-513-3076.
Welcome back to Jerusalem Dateline. I'm Gary Lane with your weekly news wrap. In Europe, a French Muslim radical who fought in Syria has been arrested for killing three people at a Belgian Jewish museum last week. Dale Hurd has that story from Brussels and Paris.
The good news is that police have a suspect in the shooting at the Jewish Museum in Brussels on May 24th. An Israeli couple and a French woman were killed, and a fourth person was gravely wounded. The bad news is that the suspect, 29-year-old Mehdi Lamouche, was a French jihadist who fought in the Syrian civil war. Lamouche is exactly what European officials have feared would happen when Muslim radicals return from fighting in Syria.
Since the beginning of the jihad in Syria, many people have been concerned and said these people, when they will come back, will fight jihad in Europe. And that's what's happening.
The fact that police have a suspect in custody is little comfort for Belgium's Jews, many of whom worry that this very thing would happen and worry that it will happen again. European leaders have helped create a surge in anti-Semitism in Europe by allowing and in some cases encouraging the spread of radical Islam and by constantly demonizing Israel in the media. Belgian Jewish leader Joel Rubenfeld says today in Europe, anti-Semitism is cloaked in anti-Zionism.
Today in Western Europe, more and more anti-Semitism is hiding itself behind anti-Zionism. In Brussels, in Belgium, in France, you cannot say dirty Jew because it's prohibited by law. But you can say dirty Zionist.
Many European Jews are scared that they will be the next victims, and more are leaving. Hundreds more violent jihadists like Mehdi Namouche will be coming home too. Dale Hurd, CBN News, reporting from Brussels and Paris.
Syrian President Bashar al-Assad was re-elected in a landslide this week. Most international observers say the election was a sham. Voting took place only in areas controlled by the regime, and there was never much doubt about the outcome. The election took place despite the three-year civil war still waging in that country. That war has killed more than 150,000 people and displaced around 6.5 million Syrians. Meanwhile, the UN announced that Syria will miss the June 30th deadline for destroying its chemical weapons stockpile. The United States and Russia helped broker a United Nations agreement to eliminate all 1,300 tons of those chemicals by June 30th. But at least 100 tons remain. Well, after one of the driest winters on record, water is flowing freely in Israel. As Julie Stahl explains, it's all part of an aggressive program to take the salt out of seawater.
For years, growing demand and years of drought depleted the biblical Sea of Galilee, Israel's main supply of drinking water. It forced Israel to look for other options.
The only solution is really by sea water desalination and recycling sewage water. We must increase artificially the quantities of water in the area in order to survive this area.
While the Middle East may be oil rich, it's water poor.
This region is very arid. Some of the previous wars in this region have started over water issues.
Recently, CBN News was given a rare look inside IDE's newest desalination plant in the coastal city of Hadera.
What we'll do here is a desalination process, one of the most advanced in the world. Today, this desalination plant is the largest operating desalination plant in this technology worldwide.
This plant currently supplies about 10% of Israel's drinking water, desalinated through reverse osmosis.
Just 42 minutes ago, this water was in the Mediterranean Sea. Now it's good for drinking.
IDE Technologies has built 400 plants in 40 countries. At one time, it even supplied Iran, Israel's arch enemy, with this technology. With the water crisis looming throughout the region, Israel hopes it can meet its growing water needs through desalination.
In Israel itself, there's a plan for three more large-scale plants that altogether would bring the desalination capacity in Israel to 80% of urban portable needs, or some 60% of overall needs in Israel.
With the world population increasing, Felber says, countries like China, India, and even some parts of the U.S. will rely on desalination plants for water. And Israel can help with its technology. Julie Stahl, CBN News, Hadera, Israel.
Well, coming up, it was the worst violence against Egyptian Christians in 700 years. Some of the survivors share their stories.
Attention, sleep apnea patients. Are you tired of the expense and hassle of getting your CPAP and BiPAP supplies? Are you fed up with dealing with ill-fitting, leaking, or worn-out masks and straps? Are you worried about the effects that unsanitary tubes, cushions, and filters have on your health? If you said yes to any of these questions, Allied Medical Supply Network has the solution to your problems. You could qualify to have your supplies regularly delivered right to your door at little or no cost to you. That's right, no more inconvenience, no worn-out masks and straps, no more unsanitary equipment, just restful sleep. Call Allied Medical Supply Network today to determine if you may qualify to receive your fresh, brand-name supplies at little or no cost. Don't delay. Call us now to see if you are eligible to save money on regular delivery of your CPAP and BiPAP supplies. Call 1-800-815-9947. That's 1-800-815-9947. Or go to CPAPSupplyHelpline.com.
Announcing an important breakthrough in healthcare that can benefit everyone. If you or anyone you love needs affordable health insurance, regardless of a pre-existing medical condition, call Quick Insurance 123 today and get the immediate relief you deserve. Quick Insurance 123 was created to provide affordable health insurance to all uninsured Americans, with or without pre-existing conditions. This is not a discount card. This is a real insurance program that lets you choose from many affordable health plans, with access to doctors, hospitals, emergency services, and more. So call the number on your screen now and get the health coverage you need, just for calling. As a special bonus, we'll send you a free prescription savings card that could save you up to 85% on your prescriptions. That's right, you could save up to 85% on your prescriptions, just for calling. Call Quick Insurance 123 to find out how you can get affordable health insurance and receive your free prescription savings card, just for calling. Don't wait. Getting a free quote is as easy as 123. Call today.
Egyptians overwhelmingly elected General Abdel Fattah al-Sisi as their new president. He was the one who led the ouster of Mohamed Morsi and the Muslim Brotherhood last year. But because of that, Christians suffered greatly because radical Muslims took out their anger on them. George Thomas takes us to the center of the brutality.
August 20th, 2013.
We were at work when we heard Muslims were burning churches.
In the small village of Delga, 4 hours south of Cairo.
Allah! Leaders in the mosques were telling Muslims to attack Christians and kill them.
Boutros and his father, Eskander Tos, both Christians, were in their family barbershop when a mob of Muslims attacked them.
They broke into the shop, took everything, and burned the place down.
Boutros managed to escape. His father wasn't so fortunate.
They caught my father and shot him multiple times. Then they dragged his body to the mosque.
Warning, the following images are graphic. That afternoon, someone with a cell phone recorded this video of Boutros' father's body riddled with bullets being dragged through the streets.
When they reached the mosque, they tied his body to a tractor and dragged him through the village again.
The mob continued to mutilate his father's body, all the while chanting Allahu Akbar Arabic for God is great. He was buried hours later in a nearby cemetery. Boutros and his family have since escaped from Delga.
We have no money, no clothes, no job. Our home is destroyed. Our business is destroyed.
Delga is part of the Minya province, center of the worst violence against Christians in seven centuries.
300 homes, 100 businesses, 15 churches, and about 10 Christian organizations were destroyed in my province.
Anba Makarios is head bishop of Minya's Coptic Church, home to the largest number of Christians in Egypt. Makarios says the killing and arson attacks happened because Christians supported the removal of former Islamist President Mohamed Morsi and his Muslim Brotherhood government.
But the cost to Egypt's Coptic community has been staggering. More than 100 churches, hundreds of homes and businesses destroyed. And today the government says it will try to rebuild all the places of worship. But the big question, what about those who have lost everything, their livelihood and their homes?
Christians in Egypt are expecting death at any time.
Days before this interview, Makarios was the target of an assassination attempt. Driving through a town in Minya province, gunmen began firing at his car.
I thank the Lord I'm still alive, but I'm like anybody else in Minya. We all face dangers. My life is not more precious than any other soul in Minya.
Christians make up about 10% of Egypt's 80 million population. They face daily harassment nearly a year after Morsi's ouster and the government's crackdown on the Muslim Brotherhood.
They put a gun to my head and in my mouth. I started to pray, Lord, my life is in your hands, and I'm ready to go when my time is up.
We've concealed Joseph's identity for security reasons. He was abducted late last year by seven gunmen and tortured for 2 days.
I call them the 48 hours of death. No food, no water, no light, no sleeping. I was blindfolded that entire time and they kept beating me, punching me in the face. I asked one of the kidnappers, why do you just kidnap Christians? And he said, Christians are weak. They don't retaliate with violence and they have money.
The men initially demanded a ransom of $80,000. After hours of negotiations, they settled on $43,000. Still a huge sum that Joseph says his family could not afford to pay. That's when friends from his church stepped in.
I had some money in savings, but the rest of the ransom money came from church members. I cannot thank them enough for saving my life.
Makarios says the security conditions have led several hundred Christian families to consider leaving Minya. But he encourages them to stay.
We are telling the church that they must endure the persecution. We must consider it an honor to endure this persecution. Otherwise, it will contradict the level of our commitment to our faith.
Joseph is praying the country's Christians will see better days.
The Muslim Brotherhood's time in office almost destroyed our country. But we are thankful they never had the opportunity to finish their term. Now it will take some time to secure our country.
Meanwhile, Boutros and his family are still hiding in an undisclosed location, but hope to one day go back home to Delga.
Christians view the current situation as an opportunity to witness about Christ through our suffering. We have to be tolerant and keep praying for our enemies.
George Thomas, CBN News, reporting from Minya Province, Egypt.
When we come back, a Christian ministry helps both Jews and Muslims in the Holy Land.
Do you have an idea for a new product or invention? Hi, I'm George Foreman. People ask me all the time, George, how do I get my idea in front of companies? How do I get a patent? What do I do next? Do you have the same questions? I'll tell you like I'll tell them all. Call my friends at InventHelp.
InventHelp has been helping inventors for more than 30 years and has sales offices nationwide. InventHelp can provide patent referrals and submit your invention to companies who are interested in receiving new ideas. If you have an idea and want to try to patent it and submit it to companies, you should call InventHelp today for free information.
Listen, I can't guarantee your company will be interested in your idea, but I believe every inventor deserves the opportunity to step into the ring and take their best shot. Put InventHelp in your corner.
For your free inventor's information, call 1-800-461-9290. That's 1-800-461-9290.
If you had a choice between going bald and a full head of hair, which would you choose? Advances in medical science have resulted in the world's first and only permanent solution to hair loss.
Yes!
You wash it, you cut it. It's your own real, naturally growing hair. When it comes to hair restoration, no one in the world has more experience than Bosley. The results look completely natural and are affordable on nearly any budget. But the entire process can't be explained in 60 brief seconds. So to find out more about this clinically proven and permanent solution to hair loss, call now to receive your free, no obligation information kit. It'll answer all of your questions about hair loss and hair restoration. Plus, we'll also send you this $250 gift certificate just for calling. Every day you wait, you're losing more hair. So don't put it off any longer. You owe it to yourself to find out the facts. Choose hair. Choose Bosley.
Call 800-868-9957. That's 800-868-9957.
CBN's Operation Blessing is reaching out not only to Israelis, but also to Palestinians in the West Bank, including an entire village in desperate need of food and medical care.
The hills of Judea are dotted with caves. For Suha and her seven children, this cave is home. They live, eat, and sleep in this tiny space with no heat, no running water, and just a few mats on a dirt floor. Suha's husband is a carpenter, but most of the time he's away looking for work.
It's hard for him to find work here. It's very difficult for us to get the things we need.
Suha and her family live in one of the poorest Arab villages in the West Bank. Many families have 10 or 15 people crowded into small shanties or tents. Others, like Suha, live in caves. The town has no electricity and very little water. People here are farmers and shepherds by trade, but the land is too dry to farm, and raising livestock is difficult for people who can barely afford to feed themselves. That's why Operation Blessing Israel decided to help the people of this Muslim village. We gave them drinking water and bags full of food, staples like rice, beans, eggs, and cooking oil. The bags also contain soap, toothbrushes, and toys for the kids. Most people here can't afford to see a doctor, so Operation Blessing also sponsored a health clinic where people lined up for free medical care. The people in this village say they won't forget their visit from Operation Blessing, and Suha is grateful to get extra help feeding her children.
We needed food. Thank you. This food is very big help to keep my children healthy.
Well, as you can see, there's also some good news coming out of the Middle East. That's it for this edition of Jerusalem Dateline. I'm Chris Mitchell. We'll see you next time right here in Jerusalem.